I'm having a little bit of microphone trouble occasionally, so if you hear some static, just see if you can put up with that. I don't know. I haven't really been checking to see how bad it is, but it's creeping in here and there. So today's about the 22nd. Was it 17 days or something till the U.S. election? So good morning, good afternoon, good evening, whenever you're watching this video. I'm doing great, just great. So better than great, actually. I'm hitting on all cylinders, and so tremendous clarity has arisen this morning in all directions. So how do you make a video when the clarity is in all directions? Well, you can mention some of it, actually. For instance, I was doing some exercise this morning, and I was doing all the stuff I've never tried before. Different exercises, which is what we do across training in terms of push yourself to do something you haven't done before. That you find, oh, wow, that's difficult, and it's very helpful. And I was able to do it. And then I said, okay, wow. And I felt the wow reaction. And I said, okay, that's enough. Don't push it too far. And so this, and then went to something else and did that a little bit. Wow, I can do that. Okay, great. Stop. Now you know you can do it. So don't try to push yourself too much. This is the key to success in the spiritual and what we're trying to do spiritually, to reach the spirit of abidance, to not reach it, but to accept it. Stop trying to leave it, really. We're going to accept, no longer trying to leave the spirit of abidance. That's the more accurate way of putting it. And so on, when you're engaged in this as what we are, being repentant, you have to repent, otherwise you cannot succeed at all. Things just get worse. You have to wow your success. Okay, so this morning, the key is to wow your success. Always keep this in mind. I was considering this morning how to help those who are reaching out to help for help to me, and ultimately I came to tell them you have to wow your success. This is how you do it, and they only see their problems. And what I would say is, see your success, see your success. What are you doing that's successful? You've repented. You're aware of continuity fear. You're doing these things. Those are enormous successes. You have to start recognizing you're listening to great advice. You're connected with the Dharma Kings. This is like unbelievably great success. It's wow success, tremendous success. And this is where we fail, is we fail to see our successes, because continuity fear has us just focusing on, oh, what are my failures, our difficulties, problems. The way to success is to get used to success, meaning become aware of your success you already have. And ultimately, the spirit of abidance is something we already are abiding in abidance. We're just trying to leave that. And we're struggling to try and leave it. And all these problems are really the problems of how do we leave our success? Well, guess what? We can't. We can't. So that's why you have to get used to tremendous success, because you can't leave success. It's impossible. So this completely flips the script, and you just don't hear this in the world. Now, also, I was going about today and interacting, and when you're around someone who's crazy, you gotta, for me, you act crazy. Otherwise, they'll think you're crazy. They don't know, realize they're crazy. So you just put on an act like, yeah, I'm crazy too. And they say, oh, you're kind of crazy, a little crazy. Oh, it's okay. But if you don't do that, they're going to start feeling like, their craziness will become apparent and say, wait a minute, wow, you're crazy. And they'll project it. So when in Rome, do as Romans do. When you're around crazy people, act a little crazy so they think you're normal. The problem is when everybody's crazy, is you have to act crazy all the time, and you don't have any time to drop the act. So we're all caught up in this, and we've forgotten, how do I drop this act of being crazy? Ah, I know. It's like that. It's amazing, isn't it? You come into this world, everyone's crazy here, and you start trying to get along. So, crazy here, crazy here, crazy. And before you know it, you start thinking you are crazy. It's insidious, isn't it? It's very insidious, this world. Extremely insidious. We come here, and somehow we end up getting pulled into this losing track of our success. I know how it happens. You have to talk about mother. I mean, the problem is mother, essentially, is the flesh, is thinking that it knows what's best for you. And so as I'm doing these exercises, I'm saying, I'm going to stop when the Holy Spirit, my spiritual intuition tells me now's the time to wow my success. Where and then realize, say, yeah, but mom would like hey Bob, look, I'll do it more. Look, I'm even better. And you push it too far to try to impress mom. You have to get past trying to impress mom. A hug from mom isn't enough. Okay, a hug from the mother is not enough. That's not it. It's not enough. We have to be able to monitor our own wow, our own success, the wow of it, and know when to back off and say, okay, the wow is there, so let me shift over to here. So that's what I was doing with the exercises. I kept shifting, 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 shifting. And I was doing this for my own intuition instead of mother's intuition. Mother's intuition has to do with the belief in time, space, process, and form. The belief there is a way to leave abidance. And the mother is this sort of nurturing, nurturingness that helps nurture your path away from abidance. This is what this whole world is about. Just don't worry, I'll give you a hug along the way. You just have to work harder at it, and this causes mental illness. In fact, if we don't recognize continuity fear, we're going to be mentally ill. In fact, the unrepentant are actually mentally ill. This is a fact. And they don't want to hear this, of course. So you don't hear this said very often. I don't have anybody to please, really, so I can say it. But those who have not repented are actually mentally ill. They're crazy. And this is playing out in the world right now. The world is full of crazy people right now. There's no crazy minds. Very much so. The repentant are not crazy. As soon as you repent, you're not crazy anymore. You're not mentally ill anymore. You have a burden of having to evaporate that continuity fear, but you realize, hey, I can do it because I'm not crazy anymore. Because the craziness, it's like a miracle. The craziness comes from not recognizing continuity fear and thinking your problem is something else. At that point, continuity fear is a dictator over your life. And when continuity fear is a dictator over your life, you're going to be crazy, plain and simple. As soon as you realize, oh no, this is just a problem that I have, it's my own continuity fear based on a, familiarity issue, like I've forgotten what sanity is, right? Because I've been acting crazy for so long, I forgot what sanity is. I'm afraid of this. It seems like weird, some vague, nebulous abyss. It's continuity fear. As soon as you recognize continuity fear, what it is, then you say, oh, that's my trouble, but I can work on that. And so you don't let it dictate to you anymore, and therefore you're not crazy anymore. And you feel fundamentally different. When you repent, you feel fundamentally different. You no longer feel crazy. You say, well, I've got a lot of work ahead of me, but I can just work at it, and I'll be fine. I'll succeed. So you realize right then and there that you're going to succeed. So you stop playing these mind games of insanity, which is continuity fear, just playing mind games to make you think that, you can leave success. And this twists your mind up in knots, and this way and every which way, and you're mentally ill. So repentance is essential to be saved, essential. This is true. Throughout history, this has been taught, and it remains exactly the same as far as this issue goes. You must repent. You must see continuity fear as the problem. Recognize it. As soon as you recognize it, your life, it will never be the same. You realize, I'm not trapped. I'm not trapped. I'm not trapped. I'm going to get out of this craziness. I'm going to drop this crazy act that I've been doing, and I've forgotten what I really, I've forgotten sanity. I've forgotten what sanity is. If we simply forget what sanity is, you know, we all have the answer within us, but we've just forgotten it, or it's become unfamiliar to us, and it scares us. The unfamiliar scares us. We just don't trust it enough. We keep thinking, no, I've got to leave it. How do I leave it? I got to be real smart to leave it. That's continuity fear telling you that. Nothing else. Reality isn't telling us to leave reality. We just tried to do so on a venturous whim. But now we're afraid to drop the act of insanity. Afraid to drop it. And so we keep clinging to it. As continuity fear just helps us cling to madness. Helps us cling to madness. So the world is again an insane asylum, actually. And those who have repented, they're very focused, they're very serious in terms of really getting after it. Now, in order to evaporate the continuity fear quickly and smoothly, it needs to be quick and smooth, or else you start falling back into bad habits. You have to recognize the wow and shift off of what you're doing so you allow the success of that to be accepted instead of pushing and pushing and pushing until you fail and you say, okay, I failed. Like you do some new exercise and I was like, wow, I did it. And then part of me saying, well, yeah, you did it, but can you keep doing it? You know. And then I said, I'm so wowed out right now that it's not really a fair question because the shock of that I was able to do it in the first place is causing me to feel tired and stressed out. So I might very well, if I keep doing it, fail at it. So that's stupid to do that, right? Very stupid. So it's this stupidity that we have of trying to please mother, who we think has the nurturance for us to lead to abandon our success, is we actually push ourselves too much. Until we fail, and then we say, oh, you see, I did fail. I'm a failure. Then I need to get a hug from mother, because you know she helps. She commiserates me in my failure. I'm right back in the trouble. Now we have the United States, very enraging situation. We face either a dictatorship by feminist by mother, big mother, or maybe a dictatorship by father sort of thing, Clinton and Trump. So, you know, it's very possible we're choosing between two dictatorships. Well, isn't there a third option? Yeah, how about liberation from that? How about a spirit of abidance? Manjushri, the spirit of abidance rests upon me. How about that? Oh yeah, yeah, right. Let's focus on that as a solution instead of putting ourselves under a dictatorship. And I think we may be being played for a trap. This is how many see it, and it's certainly possible that Trump is merely making Clinton seem acceptable because he seems so outrageous and is bothering people so much. He's a crazy male dictator, is going to get us, destroy us all. And we're so blinded by our fear of Trump that we've been blinded to how terrible Hillary Clinton is, actually, and the extreme dictatorship that she's going to bring about, the dictatorship of radical feminism and mother worship. And I'll tell you what, if you had to choose between two dictatorships, a dictatorship of the mother, feminism, the mother, or a male dictatorship, I would choose the male dictatorship. It's much easier to get free of that than it is to get free of a dictatorship of mother. That's very difficult. And so I think this is what a lot of us are feeling, is saying, yeah, wow, it's a pretty risky choice we have right now, isn't it? But again, if we're going to have dictatorship and troubles, I'd prefer to be a male dictatorship. There are ways to get around that. There are ways to get free. Throughout history, we've managed to get free of that. But when you get a extreme mother dictatorship, that is extremely difficult to get free of. And it took these great spiritual figures in history to help liberate us from the ancient matriarchy. I mean, pagan Europe was a matriarchy. You know, a warrior goddess, very severe, and Christianity helped liberate it to some extent from that. Ancient history was a matriarchy, very, very severe matriarchy. It was horrible. It was a terrible enslavement. It was just absolutely horrible. And this paganism, you know, mother goddess worship, warrior goddess worship, and all this, it broke. It reemerged in Europe. It keeps reemerging. La Conquista, Spanish La Conquista, it reemerged in that, and they used the label of the Virgin Mary from Christianity and just attached it to their warrior goddess, and you know, wreaked, you know, mayhem throughout the Americas and the world under the banner that they were advancing Christianity. What nonsense! So it's very difficult to get free. Once you go lapse back into mother worship, it's extremely difficult to get free of that. You have to turn towards the Holy Spirit and your own intuition and managing your awareness. Okay, you are this pure awareness. You're even beyond what we can say about anything. We are not a body at all. The flesh has nothing to do with what we are. The mother did not create any aspect of us whatsoever. Neither did Father, in terms of flesh, mother, and flesh, father. Nothing to do with what we are. Zero. Zero. They themselves are just a product of our own spiritual imagination. All of this is. So they did not. Mother has nothing to do with creating what we are. Zero. She doesn't understand what we are at all. Has no understanding whatsoever. Okay. So, but it's how we, the dance of continuity fear, it's how we avoid recognizing that we're perfect success. We can't leave our success. We can't leave abidance. It's not possible. It's how we think it's possible. So it's really arrogance on our part. So, you know, but you have a tough choice. I'd go with the male dictatorship. That can be pretty easily worked around. Pretty easy workaround. Not so the female dictatorship. Not so. That's like being caught in a spider web. And you get wrapped up like a cocoon. And the fact that this is what's happened after 60 years of feminism is most people are wrapped up in a cocoon now. They can't get free of it. They can't see through it. So we have to be able to catch the wow spiritually and say, okay, and now this is the essential skill to wow your success. And so you have to look at what interferes with this, what interferes with it. And very importantly, we have to realize the drugs, sex, drugs, rock and roll sort of attitude interferes with it. You have to be very sober to be able to recognize the wow and then say, okay, that's enough. I was successful. Don't let me ruin that success. Let me get used to that success. Now, when I was at the golf driving range, I was having tremendous success, and those high school girls came, and I said, wow, I could really mess with my success. I tried to prove something, and I say, well, look, I'm so successful. I said, wow, I could see the trap there. And ultimately, I was able to just ignore them completely and just keep hitting it great. And then I left one golf ball there. See, it's very important. I said, look, I'm not going to tempt fate, because what if I hit that one bad and leave on a sour note? No, just let it stay there. So don't push yourself too far when you're having success. Be aware of the wow. Don't get blinded by the success you're having. Be aware of, you know, how amazing is this to you? How shocking, like, wow, this is, I just, you know, I'm doing something great. That's more important, is to let that sink in and get used to it rather than trying to push yourself too much. So of course, drugs drastically interfere with that. If you're in this sort of mindset, the sex, the drugs, and the rock and roll mindset that the world is so much into, okay, you cannot accurately assess how you feel. You have to accurately assess it and get it like that. Say, hey, I feel pretty wowish. I said, I don't better not try this. So I was trying this exercise of leaping onto the ball with one leg and then jumping back off of it, one of those big balance balls. And I was like, wow, that's really intense. That's awesome. And then the idea came to me, well, how about jumping on with two legs? And I said, yeah, I could do that. But then I said, you know what? This success I've had right now with one leg is so much. It's so profound. I'm feeling it. That's enough for right now. I'm not going to try the two-legged thing. I'll do that down the road. It's a great idea, and I'll do it down the road, but not right now, because this is enough success for me right now. Okay? So this is the wisdom that enables us to truly abide in success and realize we can't leave it, is to say, as we get used to this feeling of success, is to say, that's enough success for me right now. Let me get used to this first. And then a little later down the road, I will get to that jumping with 2 feet. That's going to be really intense, even more intense, actually. If I tried jumping with 2 feet, I might have fallen. It might have been too much for me. I might have panicked. I might have said, wow, success is scary, you know. This is the danger. So you have to be very sober. This is why good habits are preached in cultures that are helping us towards accepting that we cannot abandon success. It's impossible. Is that you're brought up so you have very good habits to and you don't have this terrible culture we have now in the world. Sex, drugs, rock and roll, violence, all this kind of stuff. It's the video games are so terrible. It's such terrible training for people, for young people especially. So terrible. Rack, 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 rack. Oh, I'm still being shot at. I gotta keep fighting. You completely override the wow of your success. This teaches you to be oblivious, to be in like a fighting mode. So ruinous, all this stuff for success, for recognizing that we can't leave success. So our misery, hell is just the belief we can leave success, abidance. Hell is the belief that we can leave what we are. That's hell. So as long as we keep believing that, we'll still be in hell, suffering mental illness, the ravages of mental illness, and projecting on the body, and then you have the ravages of physical illness. Mental illness comes first, then the physical illness is just attempt to displace the mental illness off and blame the body. Say, no, I'm not mentally ill, it's the body's sick. Right? So you must repent. You must recognize continuity fear. You have to clean up your habits. You have to dump those habits that bring you out of spiritual sobriety. Now, the other facet I've recognized clearly is we're in a crisis in the world now. We're going to go into very, very, very crisis. We're either going to have a dictatorship one way or the other. It looks very much that way. I mean, Trump is a sort of a dictatorial person. There's no question about it. But then again, you know, there's ways to get around that. Whereas Hillary Clinton is a very dictatorial person, and yet she's hiding under the cloak of motherhood and sisterhood and femininity and prim and proper and all this kind of stuff, which is what women can do. The mother thing can do that, and so superficially, you put, like I say, lipstick on a pig. It seems like, well, she won't be so bad. Oh, no, she'll be terrible, terrible, and you know, she's a super dictatorial person, just horrible. But put the lipstick and she's a nice suit and smiles and nice hair and everything. And we keep getting fooled by nice hair. I mean, how long are we going to be fooled by nice hair? Because nice hair doesn't carry any weight here at all, okay? Nice lipstick, nice hair, nice dress. No. All right, we're looking at the mindset of the person and their track record, what they're really about. What are they really? What can they stand up to? I mean, what are they? You know, so you could see it, and you know the feminist agenda, what it is. They're very explicit about it, and it's not a sharing of power. It's a dictatorship by women. It's a dictatorship, which is falling back into mother worship, which is what the United Nations wants for the globe, actually. So she's a globalist. She's going along with a globalist mother worshiping agenda, no doubt about it. And that's ruinous. It's ruinous for your spiritual success. I got out slightly off on a tangent because I said, wow, you got to I got to keep emphasizing this. So we're facing this you know, this dictatorship in the future, right? We most certainly are. So it is a crisis. It's the worst crisis in history right now, actually. So in a crisis, what do you do? Well, you take steps that you wouldn't ordinarily take if it weren't a crisis. You're more disciplined. And for me, I've said I'm boycotting certain things. You have to just say, okay, I'm going to take a year off of this bad habit. I'm not going to engage in this bad habit for the next year. That it's that kind of commitment. In a time of crisis, you make commitments that ordinarily you wouldn't make. You might say, well, I'm not going to watch TV for a week. If it's not a crisis, I'm going to take a week off from television. And you think you did something good. Okay, that was helpful. Gave you some perspective. But when you have like the worst crisis ever, you know, you don't just say, I'll take off a week from TV. You said, I'll take off a year from TV. I'll take a year off from sports. I'll take a year off from this. I'll take a year. I won't drink coffee for a year. I'm not going to drink coffee for the next year. And because this, I want to be as sober as I can be during this crisis. I have to be the best that I can be. Okay. This is what's necessary. And this is what's lacking. I've had zero feedback from anyone. I believe if I'm wrong, then if I'm mistaken, but I would say this is true as far as actually, what am I boycotting? What are you boycotting? What bad habit are you boycotting? You have to boycott your bad habits. You got to choose at least one to start there. Have to. And if they're not, you're not doing that, then you don't get it. You really don't get it. You have to step up to the plate. All right. And get up to the plate and dig in and say, wow, you know, this pitcher's, you know, is you know, trying to get me out. And we can't have that, you know, or like vice versa. If you're a pitcher, you know, this batter's trying to get a hit off me. We can't have that. You know, this is time to really bear down. There's a certain point where you have to bear down. And medicine isn't going to do that for you. You have to bear down and decide that right now I'm going to give it this extra effort. And maybe later I'll relax a bit. But right now, no, this requires my full attention for, you know, the next year or something. Commit to 6 months or something. But not just a short time. Enough so that it really gives you strong perspective. And it's erring on the side of caution. You have to err on the side of caution in terms of your discipline in a crisis. You have to. So it's bizarre, I would say, that I don't have any feedback. Does that mean nobody's doing it? I don't know. Maybe it's not saying so. But everyone has to be doing this. I mean, I'm doing it massively. Don't think that, oh, I'm beyond that. And nobody's beyond that here. Pick a bad habit and say, you know, this is, I'm going to be absolutely vigilant on this thing and this, and I'm not going to back off of this. No matter what, I'm going to prove to myself I can do this. I can take a vacation from this habit for a year. And you know what? That'll build such character in you. That'll build such confidence in you. It's just spectacular, the confidence you will get by doing this. And you prove to yourself you can do it. Because, you know, of course, mom will say, well, yeah, but, you know, don't be too hard on yourself. You know, do it for 6 months or something, or, you know, a week or two. You know. Of course, because that leads back to failure. And mom is very good at consoling failure. I understand, you know, like that. And the other hand, and then you keep trying to prove it to her that you're not a failure. But then you overdo it. You overdo it in terms of being aware of the wow. So there's two different issues here, you know, and it may seem a little tricky. There are areas that you don't want to underdo it, like your bad habits. You've got to stick with that and really knock them out. And then as far as your success goes, since you're not used to success so much, you have to make sure you wow it. And you're practicing. When we're doing something intense practice and it brings up a big wow, you've got to not overdo that. But in terms of your habits, which are just long term, you know, that kind of thing, then you got to make sure you don't underdo that. Like exercising, I'm exercising every day. So I got to make sure that I don't say, well, I've done it for a month and stop. Okay. Then within the context of exercising every day, I also have to be careful. I don't overdo it on any particular day. So you get this? There's sort of this long-term everydayness, and you don't want to cut yourself short on that. And then there's also the effort you make in the short term. Make sure you don't overdo that. And you know, we all make mistakes on that. Both ways. So you have to be very alert to manage this. You can't be in a haze, a sex, drugs, rock and roll haze. You cannot. You're going to fail. You're going to fail, and you're going to then settle for a hug from the mother, all right, and say that's you know, I can't do it. Yeah, but the mother will do it for me. Now, of course you could do it. The grace is within you. Of course you can manage it. The Holy Spirit is with you. The Dharma Kings are with you. But you have to actually do it. We all have to do it. What's so difficult to understand? There's nothing difficult to understand about it. Continuity fear just keeps conjuring up difficulty that it's not there. It's not there. So when you recognize continuity fear and the way that it works, Jesus called it the ego. I call it the dance of continuity fear. When you recognize this, it just conjures up difficulties that aren't even there. And then you're struggling with those difficulties that don't exist. And then you never get around to doing it. It's not difficult. It's only difficult if you're in a haze, mental haze. You got to knock out the drugs. You want to start somewhere, there's a good place to start. That's probably the easiest one. Drugs are like a mother substitute, commiserating you for your failure, you know? Right? It's a mother substitute. Knocking out the news is a very important one. I get people pressuring me that, and I say, no, boycott it. No, but it's good news. Yeah, the good sucks you in, so then you get hammered by the bad. I mean, that's so freaking obvious. I mean, how could anybody not see that? And they act like, why? What are you talking about? No news. I don't listen to good news. I don't listen to bad news. Okay, no news. The news, they know their game, and they know how to seduce you, sucker you in to it. And as soon as you start thinking, oh, okay, I go back some nice, some good news, and then wham, the hammer, wham, the hammer. They know very well what they're doing. They're devious. The whole news industry, entertainment industry, they're insane. And insanity is very devious. And ultimately, I realized, wow, I just keep getting hammered. I keep trusting them, and every time I trust them, they hammer me. Yeah, I've been hammered so many times by the news media. Just horrible. They have earned complete lack of respect. All right. In fact, they've earned us to ignore them, actually. They're the ones that need to be ignored at this point. We don't need them. Okay. We have wowing our success, recognizing our success. We already have our success, okay? We don't need you, news media. We don't need you entertainment world. okay, we don't need you. We're not paying any more attention to you. You need to repent. All right? Don't pay attention to those who have not repented. Don't pay any attention to them. They don't deserve it, your attention, actually. Because they're only trying to pull you down into failure so they feel better about their failure. They say, oh, you know, see, you failed too. So, you know, there is no success. And I feel good about that, so I feel better. No, that's a ridiculous ploy of insanity to say that if to say there's no success, therefore I feel good, that makes me feel good. This is craziness. And yet they don't see that. So don't pay any attention to those who haven't repented. Don't pay any attention to them. They have to earn your respect, your attention. Attention is the most valuable commodity you have. So only put your attention on that which deserves your attention, that you're well served by it, truly well served. And don't put it anywhere else. This is a lesson, a tough lesson we all have to learn. And I've had struggled terribly with this too. You know, sports really deserve my attention? I said, no, they don't. Not really. No. They don't deserve it. Does the world deserve my attention? No, it doesn't. Actually, the world doesn't even deserve our attention at all. It's just an insidious device to lead us into a spirit of non-abidance. So the world does not deserve our attention. Now again, when in Rome, do as Romans do. So you might act crazy like you're giving some attention to the world, but it's just an act. Just an act. What deserves our attention? Our success deserves our attention. And what is our success? Does that have something to do with the world? No, it doesn't. Our success is realized I don't need a world. There's never even been a world. I don't need an illusion of a world. Now, we could still be here, but we won't see it as a world. You know, the belief that this is a world is delusion. Yesterday, I've had a couple of glimpses the last couple of days of the spirit of abidance. Okay, Longchenpa said he'd get me into a spirit of abidance, so I trust him, and I'm expecting success in this. And I'm starting to get little glimpses of it. It's like all the world is just a movie on a screen, and suddenly my attention shifted to the screen. I just noticed. I said, oh. And everything is just moving on that screen. So everything's perfectly on the screen, isn't it? So there's the perfection. There's nothing that wanders off the screen. Everything that appears on the screen is appearing on a perfect screen. The screen is perfect. So that's the emphasis that I'm seeing. And then so I saw that, I'm seeing it, and noticing it, and say, oh, okay, that's great. Okay, that's the spirit of abidance. But then I wow it. I don't try to grab a hold of it or anything. I did. Okay, say, okay, wow. That's good. You know, that success is arriving. Just like working out, but I'm not in a hurry. I'm both in a hurry and not in a hurry. I don't get frantic. Say, oh my gosh, this is it. You know, this is what they said. I just, no, because that clouds your mind. I said, okay, let me just get used to the success. I'm starting to get these little glimpses of success. And then I go back to, you know, Manjushri, Pavasamava, spirit of abidance, Longchenpa, Jamyang Kenzi Lodro. I am not a body, I am free. The spirit of abidance rests upon me. Manjushri, Pavasamava, spirit of abidance, Longchenpa, Jamyang Kenzi Lodro. Spirit of abidance rests upon me. The spirit of abidance rests upon me. And just wowing my success. So when I have these little breakthroughs, what I do, I wow my success. I say, wow. That's tremendous success. Seeing that tremendous success, that is, you know, it is. So you have to wow your success, because we're going back to getting familiar with perfect success. So of course you have to get used to that, and so you have to what we're and we're not used to it. So it produces this wow reaction, like wow, I didn't know I could do that. That's shocking. So you have the path is the path of wowing your success. Recognizing, wow it. Recognize it, wow it. Recognize, wow it. Recognize, wow it. I've been doing a lot of video editing, and wow. Producing some stuff to do with it's interesting. A lot of it is in the editing, actually. I'm doing different stuff, doing some slow-mo, the regular motion, and suddenly it goes into slow-mo and then back to regular motion. I figured out how to do that. So I'm figuring out how to do various things. I put a poem and I figured out how to do the text there. And so I'm sort and then you play with the saturation, the brightness, and then the contrast, and the fill light levels and various things, and you give different effects that make it seem like a little surreal, and a lot of it's in the editing. So you go out and you get as much footage as you can of, and then you go back and you start editing scenes. This is a nice scene. Let me edit this scene. Let me edit this scene. Let me edit this scene. That's why you get something that looks really nice. They might spend months on editing of just, and it's so, everything seems so smooth and wow. It's just like, wow, there's something about this. It's in the quality of all the edit work that they do. A lot of it. And also the right camera angles and various other stuff. So I'm putting some of that together to just to help. Help us realize that we're not, even if the whole entertainment and music industry vanished tomorrow, we'd still have plenty of entertainment here. It would be enough, wouldn't it? For me, it is. Like for me, just singing harmony with the Beach Boys, that's enough musical entertainment for me. I entertain myself that way. I don't need anything more. It's more entertaining than any listening to any music or going to any concert, anything like that. I'll tell you what, the truth is, when I'm driving and I'm singing harmony with the Beach Boys or George Jones, I'm being more entertained than if I went to any movie, any concert, anything the entertainment industry could provide for me. I'm being way more entertained. I'm having way more fun. Way more fun. And when I'm taping, I'm having way more fun than Hollywood's having, actually. It's just a blast. It's just so wow. It's just, whoa. It's so intense, I can hardly tell you. It's just so I'm having so much fun. Like I said, it's probably going to be illegal soon, and it will be. We're going to be under so many laws of mother laws to pull us into the matriarchy, and to say no, that they'll provide the fun for us. That all of this is already, nobody does it anymore. They're too afraid. Maybe it's not politically correct. I think they might get in trouble at some point. Oh yeah, the fear is just hideous. I mean, just simple stuff like my dad would have done back in the 50s, 40s, 50s, 60s, stuff that nobody would really worry about at all. Now you feel this insane fear and pressure that you shouldn't be doing this. And nobody's doing it. They're all terrified. So everybody's trying to fit in this roboticness of the matriarchy. Like, how do I be happy in this matriarchy that's already here? And again, I think that Trump may be just part of it, blinding everybody to how terrible Clinton is, actually, just how awful it is. And we're thinking like, oh, she's saving us from Trump. How wonderful. And we end up embracing the devil, It's like that. Pretty tricky, huh? So that's why I got off Trump right away. I took a look and said, okay, let's give it a break for a year. Let's just pay no attention and then see how it plays out later, because it's very tricky. Because that's what's happened. He's blinded the people to how terrible Clinton is. I mean, if it weren't for Trump, nobody would vote for her, I mean, people don't really want that. We don't want the Clintons again. Are you kidding me? We don't want them. We want them no closer than 1,000 miles away from the White House, basically. We already had them for 8 years. It was sickening. It was absolutely the moral decay, the decay that took place during their presidency was just sickening. Revolting. And yet here everyone's saying, oh yeah, this she'll save us from Trump, you know. So it's very likely a double team. Very likely a double team. This is how the ego, this is how continuity fear works. It has this tricky double team where it gets you to accept what it wants you to accept by contrasting with something that's just really overblown and scares you, so it drives you into the arms of what it really wanted to drive you into the arms of, which is this matriarchy, which is the best form of delay there is. It's the most insidious form of delay there is. So the patriarchy came along to liberate us from the matriarchy. Okay, and then that's easier to liberate your, once you have the patriarchy, then it's easier to liberate yourself from the patriarchy than it is to liberate yourself from the matriarchy. So patriarchy is just a half step. It's not the full step. And if you stall out, then you're going to start complaining about the patriarchy and go back in the matriarchy. And then you're really, you know, jumped out of the frying pan into the fire. Or worse. That's what's happened. So again, it's way easier to liberate yourself from a patriarchy than it is from a matriarchy. Way easier. So those are going back into this, you know, matriarchy here. They're in, you know, severe delay mode, very severe. And you have to gear it up again for another cycle of patriarchy, but this time, be more recognized and say, hey. I got to go fast on my spiritual path because I can't stall out. If I stall out, then I'm going to start, then the patriarchy will start feeling oppressive, too oppressive to me, and then I'll go back to the matriarchy, and then I'm really stalled out. So we got to just live and learn, and we'll take the lessons from what's happened here and apply them down the road. So me putting myself through all this, these lessons have been burned into me very severely. And be able to help out, be very adamant in the future, saying, no, you've got to go fast. You cannot stall out. So when you're on the spiritual path, you have to be committed and you have to be dedicated. You got to gut it out. Like boot camp, you just say, I'm not going to wash out, you know. I don't care what it takes. I am not going to wash out. And that used to be that way. Like if you joined the Marines or something, your family might have been history with the Marines. You're not... The shame of washing out is so severe that it's not a possibility in your mind. You say, there's no way in the world I'm going to wash out. I'll do whatever it takes to succeed. I am going to succeed. I'm going to be a Marine. So you go through the training, and there are a lot of times like you feel like quitting. Like you say, I just can't take it anymore. But the shame of quitting is so severe that you don't quit. You just say, man, I'm going to have to find a way. And this is that kind of shame is what you need. The shame of failure is so severe, you just don't fail. You need that sort of commitment on the spiritual path. And it's great that the fear of going back into a matriarchy is so terrible. For me, this is, I can't fail. You know, I simply cannot fail at the path. It's, you know, totally unthinkable. Totally unthinkable for me. The hideousness of it. The mental illness of it, and how in an effort to avoid mental illness, it goes into violence. This is what happens. Keep in mind that the ancient times are extremely violent times. And those were matriarchies. The real power rested in the matriarchy back then. And then, yeah, the men were the warriors, and you know, but it was a warrior. It was a violent, hideously violent, vicious culture. And there was a crossover time where the patriarchy started coming in, where it got blurred. You know, we look back in history and think, no, it was the patriarchy that caused. No. It was the long history of matriarchy that had such intense mental illness with it that this got acted out in extreme violence. And so as we were transferring over to patriarchy, that violence was still surfacing. But it got smoothed out throughout the years. It's been smoothed out quite a bit. But now it's coming back again. Coming back again very badly. As we sink back into matriarchy, we sink into mental illness, we then end up finding severe violence. severe violence, like in culture. This has happened, right? Look at the last 100 years, and just the video games, everything, as we sunk back into feminism, matriarchy, more and more violence in our lives, so much more violence. And they claim that they're here to cure that, just the opposite. Violence is an expression of mental illness projected upon the body. It's an attempt to escape mental illness and not having the tools to do it. So knowing history, you realize, wow, I can't stall out here, you know. Stalling out is not acceptable. And of course, most people are trying to tell me, no, you got to stall out. So I know how horrible it is. So this is not an option. And yet, most people would reject me if I don't. They say, no, this is the way. No, it's never the way. So the spiritual path has to be brisk. The progress, you have to have this spirit of briskness about it. Like, today is an essential day in my life that I cannot fail today. I always have had this feeling. Everything's on the line today. It's all riding on this today, and I've got to come through today. I'll worry about tomorrow. That's not even on my mind right now. What's on my mind is today. What's on my mind is right now. This is when I have to come to make the effort. This is where I have to stand, you know, stand resolute right now. I can't buckle and fail right now. Tomorrow, maybe I'll fail tomorrow, but I'm not going to fail today. So this has always been my attitude, is, yeah, maybe I will fail, but it won't be today. There's no way I'm going to fail today. No way. I will win the battle today. And tomorrow, I'm not thinking about tomorrow. Maybe I'll lose the battle tomorrow. Well, but today, I'm not going to lose it. That's for sure. And then when I get up in the morning, well, it's today again, isn't it? And I say, well, today, I'm going to win the battle today. I will not lose. Tomorrow, I might lose, but not today. And so I take it one day at a time. This is how I've lived my life, one day at a time. And just winning the battle that day. Each day I win the battle of that day, every day. And as soon as you start getting your attention on tomorrow, you're going to lose the battle today. As soon as you're thinking about winning the battle tomorrow, you're going to lose the battle today. All right? So don't ever allow that to happen. You just say, I'm going to do the best I can. I'm going to win today. Holy Spirit's going to win today. Grace of God is going to win the day for me today, for sure. So again, we've been deceived by the matriarchy using a prop of this overblown hysterical patriarchal figure like Trump. If that's how people want to see it, I mean, he doesn't really freak me out, because I know the way to get free of the patriarchy. But he's sort of a melodramatic, you know, like a cartoon character, really. So the matriarchy uses this cartoon caricature of the patriarchy, which is not representative of it really at all. Very well at all, and uses that to demonize the patriarchy and say, wow, the matriarchy is so much better than this cartoon crazy guy, you know. And it blinds us to how terrible the matriarchy is. Isn't that amazing how devious it all is? So devious, our continuity fear, when we don't recognize it, it's very devious. When we do recognize it, everything changes in terms of You regain your confidence. This is a way to put it. You suddenly just regain a sense of confidence and say, wow, I am going to get free of this. So I don't need to go down the roads of what mental illness is about, of trying to, you know, all the stuff, the mental tricks that actually is mental illness. I don't need to do that. I don't need to try to reconcile the irreconcilable. I don't need to do that. And then there's this burden then lifts off of you, and this, you start feeling confident again. So I don't have to do that. So my lack of confidence was because I was trying to do the impossible and merely seeing it as difficult. But now I see it's impossible. And the only reason why I was trying to do it was continuity fear. But if I evaporate continuity fear, then I won't even feel any need to try to do the impossible. So I won't be struggling trying to deceive myself that the impossible is merely difficult. Mental illness is the belief that the impossible is merely difficult. That's mental illness. And it's held there because of continuity fear. So we evaporate continuity fear, then we're just like, wow, I don't need to do that. I don't need to try to deceive myself that the impossible is merely difficult. You know, leaving abidance is impossible. It's not just really difficult, it's impossible. So they say, oh, that's great news. That's wonderful news, isn't it? So obviously I don't have to try to do the impossible. That's insane, absurd. Yeah. And the only reason I keep thinking I need to is continuity fear. There's no reasonable dynamic at all telling me that, right? Yeah, that's right. Reason doesn't tell us that at all, that we have to make the impossible difficult. Never tells us. Reason never tells us that. So reality never tells us that. So reason, reality, none of that tells us this. Only continuity fear, you know, is demanding it. So if we evaporate continuity fear, we're free. We're done with it. We're free. And you see it and you know it and you realize, wow, I've got you. I've got it now. I've got you. You know, you realize that I am going to succeed. And then this brings the confidence into you, right? And then you have the confidence to start pushing back against the insanity, saying, no, 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 I'm going to win the battle today. You want some of me? Well, you're going to lose. I'm going to win this battle today. The battle, you know, because I'm going to spend the day evaporating continuity fear, and that is winning the battle. You see, the way you lose is to be distracted away from your efforts to evaporate continuity fear. Then you're losing. You lose the day. But if you're focusing on evaporating continuity fear, you are winning the day. That's how you win the day. And it's a great feeling. You know, it's not overwhelming feeling. It's just a subtle feeling like, wow. It's like, yeah, like, wow, wow. I'm getting it done. And I have this feeling every day. Like, wow, I'm getting it done. I'm really getting it done. Exercising this morning was fun. I've tried not to overdo it, you know, because I really pay a severe price when I do that. Wow, I don't want to. Got to be careful. So I'm not trying to do too much. I do a little bit of this, a little bit of this, a little bit of this. Keep toning things up, strengthening a little more. Tone a little, strength a little, tone a little, strength a little. And then I did my stretching. So I stretched. I did stretching, agility, balance, and strength. Stretching, agility, balance, and strength. Stretching, agility, balance, strength. I was doing all of those. I'm kind of going back and forth among them. Not trying to do too much of any particular one. So each one of these successes, wow, that was helpful. Wow, that was helpful. Don't overdo it. Wow, that's helpful. And you could go to different tactics of evaporation. When one, you know, you think, oh, that's enough for that. It's really a tremendous wow. Okay, you can shift over here and try this one. And then shift here and try this and try this. So you could always be doing something that rounds out your success, 360-degree success. Like, I don't want to do too much jump rope. I hurt my knee doing 200. You know, I don't need to do 200. I don't need to try and, you know, overdo any particular exercise just to prove, you know, hey, Mom, look how great I am. You know, I did 200 or something. No, Holy Spirit doesn't say you need to do that. Because Mom will say, you see, you can do the impossible. You can be successful. It's just definitely difficult, right? No. No, Mom, it's not just really difficult. It's impossible. Well, then what good am I? Well, no, if you're saying the impossible is very difficult, you're no good at all, actually. And the cover, the superficial niceness is just to disguise, the no goodness. So obviously, I'm speaking to everyone here, male and female. And you're not the mother, okay? You're spirit. You're spirit. The mother is the belief in time, space, process, and form, and how continuity fear keeps us bound to try believing that the impossible is merely difficult. Spirit of non-abidance, that's just the archetype we use to entrap us. The main archetype we use. But you are not the body. You are not a male, you are not a female. You're spirit. You're this intuition. You're this awareness of wow. You're this capacity to practice. You are the spirit of abidance itself. You are the spirit of abidance. You are that. So this is not a gender issue. This is a key. The mother thing is different than gender issue. It's how we try to get comfort ourselves as we try to do the impossible, right? And you don't want to keep trying to do the impossible. So you want to get away from that dynamic and start being wise, truly wise, of learning how to manage your success, learning how to wow your success. Okay? And that comes from the grace of God. And again, it's very important to recognize it's much easier to free yourself from a patriarchy than it is from a matriarchy. So that's why I say, be careful what you ask for. You want a matriarchy, you'll get it. And you're going to also get severe mental illness that comes with that, which then gets projected onto all sorts of conflict, all sorts of stuff. Instead of recognizing, you don't recognize a continuity fear because you keep thinking, no, it's possible. And so then to try to avoid the mental illness, you project it upon the body and start acting it out and blaming the body for everything. Blame the body for everything and then treat the body. That's the matriarchy. Yeah, the patriarchy is no picnic either, right? But it's a lot easier to get free of that. A lot easier. There's been a lot of success in getting free of that. No success in getting free of the matriarchy. No success there. And so, again, win the battle of the day. All right? That's all you have to do is win today. Win today. And so I'm still, working on winning today. It's 1 o'clock, and I've done a few things. I won the battle of the scale today. All right, so there's a wow. Okay, I'm the weight's going back in the right direction. It can go in the wrong direction for me in just one day of lack of discipline, and I gained 2 pounds. It's terrible, and taking that off, is a battle. And so I just today all I've had is fresh juiced apples. I got 20 apples yesterday and juiced them. So I'm drinking this freshly juiced apple juice, and then I juiced 3 oranges, and then I used that vitamin water, and I just made a drink of those three, and I'm just drinking that. So that's all I've had today, and a couple of peanuts. So if I, I'm being strict with myself. On weekends, I'm very strict with myself, food-wise. And so I try to drop about 3 pounds during the weekend. So I'm trying to get down to a certain weight start of the next week. And this happens every week. I gain weight during the week, and I try to take it off starting Friday, starting Thursday, then Friday, hit it hard, then the weekend hit it real hard. And I just have to keep my weight down. It's very important. It's really difficult. I'm starting to feel hungry right now, actually. But I'll try to battle through it. And so there's a good discipline, because this helps with overall, flexibility, agility, balance, and actually strength is there also. I've got to make sure the strength stays there. It helps with that. It helps to be nimble. We want to be nimble right now. We want to be flexible. We want to be nimble. And we want to have strength in our core. We want to have a very strong core right now. It's really important. We want to do a lot of jumping. I'm doing a lot of jumping, leaping. It's very important. That's a core. That brings everything into play, doesn't it? That's why young people they do so many amazing things. They're very good at leaping, jumping, leaping, keeping their balance, their agility, flexibility, balance, and the strength to leap. It's we want to be youthful in that way. It helps our confidence. We want to do everything we can to help our confidence to say no to the impossible and do not accept this lie that no, the impossible is just, it's really just very difficult. But if we evolve enough, evolve our consciousness enough, we'll eventually be able to do it. But meanwhile, we'll get a hug from mother, so let's keep on trying, you know. That's what we want to say no to. And so we just have to win the battle of today. Win the battle of today. Wow our success. Wow our success. So I won the battle of the scale. I'm winning the battle of the food. I'm winning the ideological battle here. I said no to the news. Got pressured into that. And said no. I'm taping. I'm winning that battle. You know, so already I'm winning battles today. And I realize today's not over. And so I'm focused on, you know, winning the battle all through the day, all the way through. It means remembering to say Manjushri Pabasamava, Spirit of Abidance Longchenpa, Jamyan Kensi Lodro. Manjushri, the Spirit of Abidance rests upon me. Manjushri, the Spirit of Abidance rests upon me. I am not a body, I am free. The Spirit of Abidance rests upon me. I am not a body, I am free. The Spirit of Abidance rests upon me. I am not a body, I am free. The Spirit of Abidance rests upon me. Was that the phone? No. Where's my phone? I don't know. Maybe I don't have it. That's good. Oh, I do. Okay. I am not a body. I am free. The Spirit of Abidance rests upon me. So you do this and you say, wow, I'm doing it. That's great. And they say, okay, wow. Wow it. Don't overdo it. And then a little while later, you'll feel like you do some more. So you do little bursts and then wow those bursts within the larger context of sticking with it throughout the day. And you got to be careful. You have to be patient. Just like exercise. I say, wow, I just feel like I'm really enthused. I could go out, I could just push it for like hours today, but then I'd just be a wreck, you know, for the next week or whatever. But I think I want to hurry up and get fit. It doesn't work that way. Because a lot of it's mental. And I have to adjust my mental sights and say, oh, I can do this. It's easy for me. And then it becomes easy. Whereas when you mentally you think, oh, this is scary. This is very difficult. It feels difficult. So it will be difficult for you. You might get injured or something. So you have to adapt and say, hey, this is easy for me. It's no problem at all. And then you don't burn all that nervous energy worrying about it, right? And it's smooth. It's smoothed out. And it's amazing how helpful that is. That's why people try to stay in their comfort zone. With familiarity. Familiarity, they say it's easy. Yeah. But if you're familiar with trying to do the impossible, it's not easy. It's mental illness, actually. And at some point, you realize, I've got to get out of that comfort zone and establish a new comfort zone in truth, in the Spirit of Abidance. And then you have to work at it. And you have to be realistic and manage your expectations, manage your success, and stick with it and win the battle of the day. This is how it is. If you wonder why haven't we succeeded more, it's the patriarch's fault. No, it's because we've been lazy and we haven't gone briskly enough on our path. Let's not say, well, we've been lazy. Well, there's a better way of putting it, is we haven't gone briskly enough. We haven't realized how severe our problem is. This is how I would put it. We underestimate the severity of continuity fear, greatly underestimate it. The wise ones don't underestimate it. That's why they set up institutions to help us go very briskly. They say we got to do that. You don't realize just how severe the problem is. It's really severe. more than we can imagine, actually. And this is what knocks people out here. I get people, talking, saying, "Hey, I'm struggling. I didn't, I got tricked. This is a disaster. What happened to me?" Well, what happened is you underestimated the continuity fear. How vicious it is. How severe it is. You underestimated it. There's really no way to really estimate it properly. So don't worry about it. We're just focused on winning the battle today. Don't try to say, "Well, how bad is continuity fear? If I just get a number to it, that'll make me feel better." You can't get a number to it. So don't even try to figure out how bad it is. It's more severe than we realize, and so it's useless to go in the direction of calculation. It's useless, right? It's a disaster. Don't try to calculate how severe it is. Just put all your efforts into winning the battle of today. Okay, recognize it. Okay, I got a very severe problem, but it's the only problem I have. I'm going to win the battle of today with this problem, and that's all I'm focused on. I'm not focused on how long is it going to take, whatever. Hey, the problem is way more severe than we realize, so win the battle of today. That's it. And get used to that. Just get used to winning the battle of today. And ultimately, as you keep doing that every day, then winning the battle of today ultimately will mean that you're in the spirit of abundance today, and you're staying in it more and more. Everything that appears on the screen of pure awareness is perfectly on that screen. It's not imperfectly on the screen. There's nothing imperfectly on the screen of pure awareness, of intrinsic spaciousness. There's nothing impurely on that screen. There's nothing wandering off the screen. When in a movie, when you're panning, panning the camera, are the pixels going off the screen, of the computer screen? When you see the landscape is now no longer on the computer screen, did the pixels go off the screen? No, they didn't. They're still there. Nothing wandered off the screen. The light is still, all of it's still coming from the screen. So it's an illusion. We think that somehow something's being lost or wandering off the screen of awareness. No, nothing is. Everything is pure, inherently pure in this regard. Now, you might not quite understand what's being said, but you will. When you get this glimpse, you'll immediately say, "Oh, that's it. Okay, oh, that's what's been talked. Oh, yeah. Oh, that's really simple. It's obvious. Wow. How crazy. I thought that something was leaving the screen." No, what's being manifest is what's being manifest, and the unmanifest is still there as potential. It's not off screen. All manifest and all unmanifest is all on screen. There's nowhere else for it to be. It's the same screen of awareness. It's the same screen of awareness. So now I'm projecting, something on the screen. Now I'm not projecting that. It's the same screen. The screen hasn't changed. Whether something is manifest or unmanifest, it's the same screen. So the unmanifest has the same relationship to the screen as the manifest. It doesn't change the screen of awareness. like the pixels on a computer screen, they can portray any landscape or anything at all, right? So their presence is pure potentiality. So the pure potentiality of the screen doesn't disappear, depending on what we choose to see as manifest or not. And really, reality is neither manifest nor unmanifest. Manifest and unmanifest are just two sides of one coin of experiencing. So we're really simultaneously experiencing the manifest and the unmanifest. That's what our experiencing really is. It's not, we're not just experiencing the manifest. At the same time, we're also experiencing everything that's not being manifested as the unmanifest, as the contrast, as the counterpoint to the manifest. I mean, that tree, we're experiencing it because nothing else is manifesting as that tree right now. So this will all just click into place. I trust it. And it'll just be, you're winning the battle of that day. And you just say, okay, it's all clicked into place. And that's, great success, but so let me wow the success. And I know what to do to wow success, so I'm not going to measure the success at all. Is it great? Is it not great? You get a feeling like, this is a big wow. Okay, so let's just do what we do with a big wow. Don't think about it. Don't label it. Don't measure it. Don't analyze it. Just get settled. Just let the ripples settle down. That's all. Doesn't matter if there's ripples are big or small. It's the same patience of let the ripples settle down. Don't take a peek back at what caused the ripples. We know the ripples were caused, so that doesn't matter. It's letting the ripples settle down now. And don't go into a trance state or anything like that. I was starting to drift off too far into just kind of this sleepy sort of thing. No, that's not it. That's not the wow. The wow is present, and you're very much present in the now and alert, and you're alert to any drifting offness. It's not like just a sleepy, unconscious state at all. That's why you can do it with your eyes open. Sometimes it's best to do it with your eyes open, actually. Our lids partially closed, not entirely closed. This is one of the meditation tricks is I've never really tried this. I just do it naturally. Is the lids are like about 3/4 closed, you might say. Or even 7/8, but they're not shut tight. They're certainly not open. They just kind of let the lids droop down like this. Relax the lids, but don't close them. So I'm seeing just the bottom portion of the screen of perception here, but it's. Yeah, interesting. That's a really good technique. Very useful. So this way, you don't allow yourself to go into a sleepy state. At the same time, you're not really focused on anything out in the world. Now I'm able to just get the right focus with my eyes open. That's why usually my eyes are just open, but sometimes let them go down a bit. Yeah, just like that. They're not shut. Mostly shut, but not shut. Very good. Very great. Wow. So you see, we've had some success with that. I hadn't really quite explained it like that before. Wow, big success. All right, that's enough. Let's let the shock of that success go in. Let's not fool around with it anymore. Perfect example. See, a lack of confidence, we keep thinking, no, if I could just keep doing this trick over and over and over and over, I'll gain confidence. No, because what we lack is this 360-degree confidence, which is abidance, spirit of abidance. We're trying to get this fixated, linear, fixated, time-space process and form, non-abidance kind of confidence, which is useless. That's what makes us feel lack of confidence, is trying to get less than 360-degree confidence. So we don't fixate on any particular thing and try to gain too much confidence with it. The confidence we're after is 360-degree spirit of abidance confidence. And if you just work at it every day, guess what? You'll get better and better and better and better, and you realize, hey, I'm... But you won't, you know, you... And, oh, here's another tip, again, that I want to reemphasize. I know I've said this in previous videos. It's in a severe crisis, which we're in now, as we're basically going back into the matriarchy, which is disaster, absolute disaster. And we'll blind ourselves to this through a global crisis, probably. And then we'll contrast and think, oh, blame it all on the patriarchy. No, it's all blamed on our lack of briskness in the path and are not really having the tools to manage our success, not realizing we have to, underestimating the continuity fear is what really caused all this. Not the patriarchy, it's underestimating the continuity fear has caused this problem for us. Patriarchy was a helpful step if we would only have recognized the severity of the continuity fear. So in a crisis, what's really important is don't backslide. You may not be able to advance as much as you want to advance. You may have to tread water, but that's very successful as a severe crisis is coming upon us. Treading water is a tremendous success. So I'm saying, yeah, my weight is still, I'm still struggling. It's not, I wasn't able to push it down to, you know, real low. My fitness isn't really not where I want to be. I still can't do a lot of stuff. But I haven't lost any ground here, okay? And I have gained some ground. It's not gone as fast as I'd like it, but what you have to avoid is a retreat. You can't be routed. It's like, you know, battles like World War II or some of the big battles. You got to hold the line. You can't break. And so you may be in this stalemate, and you're not winning the battle, but you're not losing it. And, you know, they say, look, reinforcements are coming. You just can't lose the battle right now. Or, you know, the other side is running out of munitions. So just don't break and don't be routed. That's very important. When you're struggling and you're winning the battle of the day, you just hold the line. I'm not going to retreat. I will not retreat. I may not be able to advance as much as I want, but I'm certainly not going to retreat. This is what is crucial in a severe battle, a severe crisis like the world is in right now. Just hold your ground. Hold your ground, and you will look back and say, that was like awesome effort. Absolutely awesome effort. So don't judge yourself against a scale like, oh, I should be able to advance. What's wrong with me? No, we're in the most trying times of history ever right now. So if you are refusing to retreat, you're doing a fabulous job. Fabulous. All-time great job right now. All-time great. And you know, you'll start feeling, oh, let me go back to pastries and chocolate and stuff. And then, no. Let me get back to a more healthy, I'm going to get back to what's right. Let me have that vegetable smoothie. I didn't do that today. I went to a fruit one, fruit juice. But that's good. You know, there's fresh apples and oranges and pomegranate juice and stuff like that. I mean, that's healthy. That's very healthy. So, you hold your ground. Hold your ground. Hold your ground. Hold your ground. I'm holding my ground. If you're holding your ground, I'm right there with you holding my ground. I'm not being routed. And a lot of prayer goes into this. You know, Manjushri Pavasamava, Spirit of Abidance, Longchenpa, Jamyang Khyentse Lodro. Under no circumstances allow me to be routed. Under no circumstances allow any route to take place. I absolutely forbid it. Have the kind of prayer like this. You pray to them and say, watch after me with an eagle eye, and under no circumstances allow any route to take place here. You have to rally your courage right now. Rally it. And state it to yourself. I said, I am going to hang in here. And the grace of God has my back, and we are not going to allow any trouble to come to me. I'm not going to be routed. I'm not going to be harmed. I refuse to be harmed right now in any way. I refuse to be compromised. I refuse to lose right now. It's just not going to happen. I'm not going to lose right now. Right now. Later, I'm not speaking with later, I'm speaking right now. I refuse to lose right now. So you need to hear that coming from yourself. You hear it coming from me, but what I'm saying, say this to yourself. You've got to speak to yourself and tell yourself, I refuse to lose right now. And again, don't go back, go into the matriarchy and fall for their lies, saying, oh, the patriarchy is so terrible, it's so difficult. Come back in, we'll give you a hug, and it's all nice here, you know. No, the problem was we underestimated continuity fear. That's the problem. When you see that's the problem, then you don't fall for that lie. You say, no, I'm going to get it done, and I'm going to win the battle with continuity fear today, and I'm not going back into the matriarchy, and I'm getting free of the patriarchy. I'm getting free of both of those. I'm getting free of the spirit of non-abidance. I'm replacing it with the spirit of abidance. I see that everything that appears on the screen is perfectly on the screen, is perfectly expressed on that screen. There's nothing lacking. There's nothing lacking. Now, there's nothing lacking, yeah. There's only the now of the screen. Everything is present on the screen of pure awareness, of inherent spaciousness. So rally your spirit. Use whatever term you want. I could say Longchenpa, Longchenpa, Longchenpa. You know, he's a winner. He's a super winner. So I'm calling upon this super winner, super winner, super winner, super winner, super winner. May your spirit be with me today in my battle with today. So call upon your spiritual helpers in your battle of today. The Holy Spirit. Call upon the Holy Spirit today. Holy Spirit, I call upon you to ensure I win the battle of today. When I don't roll in the mud, the mosh pit of mud of level confusion with words, fighting word battles, you know, that's losing the battle of today. You don't do that. When you start getting to these word battles, it means you're missing the wow. You're missing the wow of your success. There's always some wow of your success you can turn to instead of these word battles, these word games. All right, always. So as soon as you start struggling with words, that's the struggle. Turn to the wow. Say, I'm somehow missing the wow of my success. Okay? This is how it's done. Now you'd say, well, I need to wait until the new age and new and sometimes so then the right teaching will come. Now this is the same teaching you're gonna get 1,000 years in the future. It's the same. It's the same. So you're having it now. Why wait for 1,000 years or 100 years or whatever, right? Why wait? It's the same teaching. It's here right now. Wow, your success. That's it. Don't get into these mind games. Wow, your success. So this teaching is a universal teaching. It's present everywhere. It's the same teaching now as it'll be 1 trillion years from now, okay? So why wait for 1 trillion years? That's absurd, isn't it? You're not going to get any different teaching, any better teaching. You know, this whole thing about we're going to get better teaching in the New Age, that's the lie. That's how we're deceiving ourselves. That's how we go back into the matriarchy. There isn't any better teaching. The teaching is very simple. You just have to manage your success. That's it. By wowing your success instead of analyzing it. It's the same teaching. That's why I can listen like to Lopa or something. I say, hey, it's the same teaching that I'm giving out right now, that's being given out now, that I'm just the spokesperson giving it out. But it's the same. It's the same. It's always been the same. Always will be the same. So don't wait for these different eras. I need to, that's the delusion. You win the battle of today. It's always will be that way. Thousands of years in the future, if you're listening to this, thousands of years in the future, guess what? You'll realize, hey, I need to win the battle of today. Yeah. You could be winning the battle of the day right now and don't need those thousands of years. You won't need them then. You won't need them. Win the battle of the day. But what I see in people in the world is they're always focused on winning the battle of tomorrow and they never win the battle of today. It never occurs to them. They keep losing every single day. They lose every single day. What happens when you do that? You get used to failure. That's how you get used to failure, is always projecting for tomorrow and never winning the battle of today. That's the spirit of non-abidance, isn't it? That's the spirit of non-abidance. And don't get cute with it, saying, well, I got to win the battle of now. Those are mind games, word games. To win the battle of today, that's enough folk. That's enough clear focus for us, isn't it? Sure it is. It will easily emerge when the continuity fears evaporated. What all this stuff that non-duality is talking about, that'll just emerge for us. We'll just see, oh, yeah, of course, it's simple. I'm seeing it. I'm experiencing it. I don't need to struggle with words about this. What's important is to keep wowing your success throughout the day. If you have a moment of winning the battle of now, you can wow the success of that. But you're going to spend the whole day, you're going to be having success. Wow, the success of the day. That's something every single one of us can do. And we will have to keep doing that until ultimately the spirit of abidance really, truly emerges for us and is present for us all the time. We'll have to keep wowing the success of the day. And even when that emerges, we'll wow the success of that. So it's the essential habit of your life is to wow the success that you're having today. Win the battle of today. This is it, and it will always be that way until until the presence of the spirit of abidance is completely accepted and stable and all continuity fear is gone, which will happen for us, absolutely. Until that happens, until that's completed, winning the battle of today is your responsibility, what you must do. You do it through wowing the success that you're having and doing it. Just by succeeding at it, you're wowing yourself. Just by committing, I'm going to win the battle today, that's a wow right there. It's a huge wow. It's tremendous. I decided I'm going to win the battle of today instead of focusing on the battle of tomorrow. And again, don't try to overdo it. The continuity fear will try to trick us again, saying, well, that's nice, but how about winning the battle of this minute or this moment or this day? You know, and then you start getting into these mind games. No, you understand the context already. You don't need to overanalyze it, overdo it. We're just committed to today, make as much effort as possible to wow success. To be aware of it, to allow it to arise. When we're committed to wowing it, guess what? It automatically arises. So this is the key to your success is be willing to wow your success, and it will automatically arise for you. So we've been doing it backwards. We keep trying to analyze, well, first I got to get the success. I can't quite understand that. Now, what about this now? You talk about the now. I need to be in the now. But what does that mean? And, you know, and we get all into our mind of analyzing, trying to figure it out, or into our emotions, trying to sort it all out. That's the wrong way to go about it. The way to go about it is to be committed, determined and committed that I'm going to wow my success. I'm going to win the battle of today by wowing my success. I don't care what the success is. I am going to wow it. And I'm not going to lose the battle of today. Okay. I'm going to keep it simple. I'm going to not try to overdo anything. You know, I'm going to manage my success properly today. And then when you're in that mood, guess what? Boom. Success just arises like a miracle. It's like a miracle. You say, I didn't do anything. It just appeared. No, you did do the essential step, correct step, which is to wow, be committed to wowing your success. Committed to being patient with the day. Okay? Don't go too fast and don't go too slow. Right? You do a little burst here. Success arises. Wow, I wow it. I calm down. Success arises again. I wow that. And I just... committed to winning this battle of the day back towards the spirit of abidance, which is realizing that the impossible is impossible. It's not just really difficult. It's impossible. There's zero difficulty to it because it's impossible, right? That's ultimately, this is aha, you know, and we accept this and everything smooths out for us. Oh, so wow, that I don't have to do that. Well, then the confidence isn't even the issue anymore, right? I feel perfect. Because I don't have to try to do the impossible. So I don't have to generate some sort of confidence to do the impossible. So I just had this net bliss then. Just blissful again. And that's what I am. Blissful spirit of abidance is what I am. The blissful spirit of abidance is what I am. The blissful spirit of abidance is what I am. So, blissful spirit of abidance is what I am. Yeah. So wow, this. Wow, that's great to see it that way. It's a discipline, isn't it? This very clear way of seeing it. Blissful spirit of abidance is what I am. Wow, great, great, great. That just arose to see as success. So this is what I've experienced. Your commitment, then you're in, like the idea just bubbles under your mind. It's just like, boom, there it is. Like, wow, where'd that come from? It was there waiting for your commitment to wow it. That's what it's waiting for. Our success is simply waiting. It's already there. It's just waiting for us, for our commitment to wow it and to manage it. And it's just waiting for that. And so when we elevate our commitment, bow, the flower starts to unfold. It starts to bloom. The flower is already there. It's just waiting for our commitment to accept the beauty of its bloom. That's it. The blooming will happen automatically from our commitment to wow the beauty of it. So this teaching here is the same teaching you're going to get 1,000 years from now in a competent situation. You're just getting it right now, so you don't need 1,000 years of misery. This is the heart. This is the heart and soul of any teaching is managing your success today. Win the battle today in managing your success, being committed to the wow of success, being committed to the blooming of the spirit of abidance, That's it. There isn't any other teaching to get, actually. So the now is just a desert. You know, don't wander into the desert. Tomorrow. Tomorrow is just wandering into a desert. No, the desert is blooming today. If we wander away from the desert, for the bloom of today, we're wandering into a very dry desert. It's all desert, but we have water here, so everything's lush and blooming, and so we have to wow that lushness of the desert. Otherwise, we'll wander off into the desert of tomorrow, where there's no water and there's no bloom at all. The desert for me is an extremely intense, profound place because you see the water and the oasis and what water does. It's so beautiful. The blooms, everything's blooming so beautifully there. But if you just wander away from where the water is, it's just, you know, dry and desolate. And you just go, wow, I want to stay where the water is. The water of wow. Wow is the water. Water of our commitment. And that brings the bloom. It's not first it blooms and then we water. It's first we water, then the bloom comes. Right? Isn't that obvious? It's not say, well, give me this beautiful blooming lushness first, and then I'll decide whether I want to bring the water of commitment and wow to it. No, it won't happen that way. It'll just keep a dry desert. Because you'll say, well, maybe I'll wow it tomorrow, but not today. Then you're not putting the water of wow on the plant, on the flower. How can it bloom? Put the water of wow today, and guess what? Tomorrow, the bloom will be there, won't it? And it'll be more and more blooms and more and more blooms and more and more blooms and more and more blooms. I love blooming flowers. We all do, right? It strikes a chord within us. I've spent a lot of time videotaping flowers and rose gardens. I've done a lot. I don't have those videos anymore. I threw them away. That was back in the 90s. And then I chased wildflowers throughout California. I mean, I was very much into that and just taped so many beautiful, just gorgeous blooms. It's something about seeing a desolate landscape just transformed by rain into a lushness, and then all these blooms. I mean, Death Valley, I was in Death Valley when they had like a 100-year bloom there, and it was just, that was so intense. Because you look out and you see, you know, Death Valley, the awesome desolation of it. And then to see everywhere you look, just see these beautiful flowers everywhere. It's just, you know, I just like can't even express. It was like being in heaven. It was an otherworldly experience. Super wowish experience. You don't even want to talk at that point. It knocks you into silence or laughter. But if there was no rain, there wouldn't be any flowers. And so the water of wow comes first. This produces then the bloom, which is even a bigger wow. So make sure your so-called future is full of this lush bloom, this very lush bloom. This is what I've aimed at. This is what I want, really want. I want my days to come to be this, you know, incredibly lush bloom, just gorgeous, sublime bloom. So I work at it. I work on today. Keep watering the mind with wow. Yeah, I've always wanted this extraordinary bloom in my life. somewhere I've got some videotape. If I just go through and edit and really apply myself to it, of all this hoping, this I set up this whole celebration that hoped it would take place, and it involved so many flowers, and I had this yard, the entire, I just was like a slave for it. I slaved, I planted, all I did was set things up, so it was a beautiful celebration with just gorgeous flowers just blooming everywhere. We were wearing flower leis. We have flower arrangements on tables, gorgeous flower arrangements everywhere. And we're just like in this world of just beautiful flower petals and flowers everywhere. I was very much into that. Now the celebration didn't happen, because we're really aiming for something higher than that. That was more of a matriarchal thing, say, settle for the external, like actual flower petals and stuff like that. But that was just a metaphor. So as things were collapsing back into the matriarchy, I was trying to think, how can I make the matri this experience, really wonderful? And ultimately, I realized you can't. It was horrible, actually. Now, the true bloom is in your mind. Spirit of abundance, blooming in your mind. Where everything is a bloom of the manifest and unmanifest. This dance, everything is this perfect dance. Everything is a gorgeous bloom. There's only that. And there's nothing you need to do in particular to make it that way. It's inherently that way. Spirit of abidance, rest upon me. Manjushri, may the spirit of abidance rest upon me. Manjushri, through your grace, may the spirit of abidance rest upon me. Manjushri means gentle glory. So this is the bloom. This is the spirit of abidance that we really want. We want this gentle glory. We want to experience this. We want this to rest upon us. This is what we really want. And it's effortless. We don't need to go, we don't need to spend time planting flowers and watering and fertilizing and all the effort that I went through. It was just, I wore myself out. I burned myself out. I became very discouraged, because then, the bad weather comes, it kills the flowers, the gophers come, the bloom would go disappears, and it's just like, oh, I'm losing the beauty of what's happening. Now the wealthy have those who gardeners who take care of all that stuff, and they just sit back and enjoy it, right? That's their trip. But I had to do all the work, everything myself. And then I realized what a bother it is, actually. What a terrible bother that is. That's why this world experience, it'll always be slavery. The matriarchy is a slave state. Basically, it's enslaving men. It's less a money enslavement, it's more of a gender enslavement. So patriarchy is based on the greed of money and enslaving both men and women, become very powerful and rich, and they have their servants and slaves, both men and women, in this. And women are served by this. They've gotten fabulously wealthy through the patriarchy, fabulously powerful and wealthy, actually. And so it's more of an enslavement through money, capitalism, whatever. But the matriarchy is an enslavement of gender, whereas as men are enslaved by women. A different type of enslavement. It's a gender enslavement. And everybody loses then. Everybody loses. So we're very, like, was it 18 days? We can count it. Today's the 22nd. 23, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 30, 31, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 17 days. We're basically looking at 17 days now. 17 days. That's like 2.5 weeks. 2.5 weeks. I mean, that's coming up just boom, right? Pretty soon, next week, burn through the next week, and it'll be like 1 week and a half away. And then we'll burn through that week, and it'll be 3 days away. And we'll burn through those 3 days, and, you know, probably it will be the matriarchy will win the day, which we fully expect. And even if the patriarchy, Trump, wins the day, there'll be so much rioting and so much trouble that, and you know, he may be, it may play out, what just makes the matriarchy look all the more attractive to us. So either way, we're going into a matriarchy in this world. But many of us will choose differently, actually. So when this happens, the election, we're going to say, okay, wow. We're not going there. Okay, we're not going there. That's for sure. That's for sure. Been there, done that over and over again. That's what you absolutely must not do. And all we have to do is say, no. We'll take the patriarchy and we'll just recognize the severity of the continuity fear and work at it more diligently, way more diligently, and we'll be fine. That's my attitude. I don't need a matriarchy. I don't need it. I don't need failure. You know, I've recognized, you know, I know continuity fear is a very severe problem. Yes, it is. It's proven to be a very severe problem. No question about it. Every day I think I've got it, but no, you know, it's tough to put that fire out. Right? Absolutely it is. But it's doable. The gurus have told me for sure I'll do it. So I trust them. You know, Ram Maharshi told me 100% for sure. He says, you are going to do it. And he says, I already see it. He says, in my vision, it's already a done deal. You've done it, already done it. And yeah, so you are most certainly going to do it. And just trust in me when I tell you this. And I did. I trusted in him. When people say, what good are gurus? Well, look no further than that. Okay, because that was essential help. I was ready really to quit and fail. And he told me, no, I see, you're going to succeed. It's difficult, but you are going to be one of the successful ones for sure. Trust me. And so I trusted him. Made all the difference. Basically, my evaluation, I said, is inferior to yours, Ramana. So I'm going to take your evaluation of me over mine. Okay? This is called, you know, trusting in the guru. And it's essential. It made the difference. Otherwise, the matriarchy would have pulled me down. I would have failed. But I said, no, Ramana, I trust you. My spirit trusts you more than it trusts the matriarchy, right? Saying that, no, you're going to fail. You're a failure. No. Ramana tells me I'm a success. He's telling me truthfully. And the matriarch is lying to me. So I put his evaluation of me. I trusted it over my own, which was compromised. You know, I was like, wow, I think I'm going to succeed, but there's all this other pressure on me saying, no, you won't. You can't. You shouldn't. You're just overvaluing yourself. Come into our arms. We'll help you out, you know, with your failure. Don't worry. You know, the siren song of all that stuff. So he set me straight. He said, no, you're going to succeed. I've got your back. I already see it. I know it. Trust it. So I trusted it. And from that point on, I really got with it. Made it, you know, extra commitment from that point on. Because in our mind we're saying, I'm going to succeed, I'm going to fail, I'm going to succeed. Both voices, we hear both voices, right? But with him, there was only one voice speaking. There was no oscillation, vacillation, waffling. In his spirit, in his countenance, in his presence, there was absolute certainty. There was no doubt, not even a tiniest shadow of doubt that I experienced with Ram Maharshi. So that set my mind at ease deep down. Now, on the surface, I still oscillate, right? We all do on the surface. But There's no surface or Ramana. It's only certainty, through and through. There's no bifurcation of certainty and uncertainty with him. It's all certainty. It's 360-degree certainty. So he said, look, my 360-degree certainty is telling you, you are going to succeed. I already know it. It's a fact. It's an absolute fact. So don't argue with facts, you know. Stupid to argue with facts, isn't it? So in the matriarchy, I'd say, oh, you're arrogant, you're egotistical, you think you're going to succeed, who are you to succeed? So, well, who are you to tell me to argue with facts? Because Ramana presented a fact to me. So if I start doubting that, I'm arguing with facts, which is insane. So what the matriarchy is really telling me to do is go back into insanity. Don't worry, we'll give you a big hug when you go back into insanity. Say, what a hero. You joined us. You joined forces with us. We'll be the world beaters here, you know. We'll do the impossible because we know it's just really difficult, but we have this mother capacity to do the impossible. We know how to make it into difficulty and then conquer the difficulty through time, space, process, and form. We'll work at it for the next couple billions of years, maybe, and we'll do it. You know, so welcome back to that insanity. I say no. That's arguing with facts. That's insane. That's mental illness. I've already suffered that. I'm not going back to that. So you see, it's vicious. The matriarchy is absolutely vicious. It's mental illness in petticoats. Okay? That's not good. You don't want to dress up mental illness in petticoats. That's why the patriarchy is a lot easier. It's much starker. It's like, wow, that's tough. Too bad. You know, it's mental illness. Yeah, well, too bad. What do you mean too bad? Ah. You know. Shake it off. I can shake it off. Wow, I don't know what to do about it. Wow. I better ask for the Holy Spirit for some help. Whereas the matriarchy says, no problem, Melos, no, we'll dress it up in petticoats and lipstick and make it look flowers and glamorize, everything's fine, don't worry, we got this, fine, you know, make it beautiful for you. So they keep trying to smooth at the surface, but keep trying to put lipstick on the pig of mental illness, and they never run out of different shades, you know. Whereas the patriarch just says, yeah, it's terrible, isn't it, mental illness, awful, but I don't know, it's got to tough it out somehow. And then that realize, wow, I need to, you know, I need to get the answer for this. You know, so it's a lot easier that way. Whereas the matriarchy, no, sweetheart, don't worry. I'll give you a hug. Let's put another shade of lipstick on this, you know, and make it look beautiful for you. You know, I'll make it all sweet for you. No worries, you know. And so it just gets worse. And don't worry, I'll help you project it. You know, no, that's not your fault. It's their fault. Not your fault. I love you, but they're the bad. And then you get into this projection game, a blame game, victimization game. Matriarchy brings this victimization game. You've been victimized by someone who's bad. You should attack them, all right? And it starts collapsing into wars, tribalism, constant conflict. Keep in mind, ancient history used to be constant conflict. Every day, you'd get up and you'd say, okay, I mean, who am I going to attack today and who's going to attack me? That's how it used to be. I mean, they'd sing songs, warrior songs. You get up in the morning, sing the song of the warrior, says, okay, I'm going out to, I mean, the Syrians would get up and say, okay, today, who do we attack today? That was their life. That's the ancient life. That's how it was. Who do we attack? Who do we kill? Who do we slaughter? Who do we mow down with our swords today or whatever we have? And pillaging and all this. And who do we bring back the booty to this? You know, to our fat cat matriarchal, you know, goddesses that are luxuriating in the flesh pots of luxury, right? Yeah. So it gets projected, mental illness gets projected into the blame game, victimization game. Someone did something they don't like. It's not your fault, honey. It's their fault. You know, oh, you know, that, oh, don't worry, sweetheart, I'll give you a hug. It's not your fault at all. You're blameless, but they're the ones who are causing your problems. They're to blame. So and then it's concretized into flesh. Like, I need to attack and destroy what's caused me the problem. So we more and more concretize everything. It's hell. It's absolute hell. Patriarchy's not nearly sophisticated like that. Say, yeah, problem. Yeah, it's terrible. I don't know, I'm not sure what to do about it, but you gotta tough it out. You know, I don't want to tough it out. Well, I don't know what to say. You know, maybe you're just a wimp, I don't know. Tough it out. Oh gosh, what do I do? Holy Spirit, help, 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 help. And then you're dealing with it, and they kind of shrug and say, well, whatever. I'm not to blame. Don't play the blame game. And so, sort of tough love, you realize I got to focus on this. It's my problem. It's my problem. Patriarch says, I'm not solving everybody else's problems. That's your problem. Matriarch says, oh no, we'll solve all your problems. Don't worry. No, it's always my problem. The continuity fear is the only problem there is. It's my problem, and that's all there. The only problem there is. There's no victimization problem. There's no cancer problem. There's no war problem. There's none of these problems. The only problem is a continuity fear problem. It's the only problem I have. It's a very severe problem. Yeah. So wowing my success is the way to evaporate this continuity fear, and that's what I'm going to do. And that's the end of the story. That's it. I've got my marching orders, and that's what I'm going to do. So the kind of the tough love of the patriarchy is very helpful, actually. Very helpful. Become much more independent. You have to realize I got to deal with my problems here. Mom's not gonna can't help me with this one. She keeps telling me that she'll help me do the impossible, which I know is impossible. It's not just difficult, it's impossible. And I know trying to do that has given rise to this hideous continuity fear, and that's what's holding me to keep trying to do the impossible, which is bound to result in mental illness and suffering and misery. So I can't keep listening to that. I've got to say, hey, I've got to keep wowing my success. And evaporate this continuity fear. That's it. That's it. So the tough love of like the patriarchy, like Trump represents this tough love. Hey, you mess up, you're fired. I'm not your mother. It's like, wow. It freaks everyone, all the matriarch, it freaks them out. Totally freaks them out. I said, no, we can't have this. People might start thinking that it's impossible instead of just difficult, and they might turn to the Holy Spirit instead of us, and then we won't get all the goodies that turning to having the power of thinking that success comes from us. We won't have that power anymore. We can't have that, because that's all the comfort and luxury and everything that comes with that. If they start turning the Holy Spirit, they don't need us anymore, so that they won't be our slaves anymore. So of course the matriarchy's freaking out. Of course they are. They're scared to death of Trump and what he represents. But again, he may just be an agent of the matriarchy. To panic us into the arms of the matriarchy. Either way, I don't know which one it is. It doesn't matter. We still, same thing. We just wow our success. That evaporates the continuity fear. Continuity fear is the only problem I have. This is therefore obviously what I need to do. Sanity itself. The practice is sanity. Continuity problem is the only problem I have. Wowing my success is the only way, is the only way to truly evaporate the continuity fear. And when I evaporate the continuity fear, no more problem. So then, obviously, this is what I need to do. Totally obvious. Totally obvious. Simple, simple, pure clarity. Just simple, simple, simple Christ clarity. How do I get to Christ, spirit of abidance, which is Christ, spirit of abidance? By evaporating continuity fear. I do that by wowing my success today, winning the battle today. So that's all I need to do. That's sanity. That's called sanity. So for me, I try not to think about tomorrow. How much can I do today? How much can I do today? How can I win the battle of today? So I'm taping right now. I'm giving everything I got to win the battle of today. And I'll let the momentum of today deal with tomorrow. Okay? Momentum is very important. I'll let the momentum of today work on tomorrow. I'll just keep working on building the momentum of today. And guess what? You carry that over till tomorrow. The momentum you're working today gets carried over. And you say, hey, I feel pretty, like I can tackle today. I feel like I got some momentum on my side here. the matriarchy is playing nice with me now, you know. I understand that. Because they want me to try and glamorize the matriarchy, so they're hoping I'll do that, but of course I won't. But I'll win the battle of today, and we'll who knows? I won't do it today, and tomorrow, I'm not worried about tomorrow. I'll just win the battle of today. And I've seen what they want. I know what they want. First step, don't vote for Hillary, okay? You don't have to vote for Trump. Just don't vote for Hillary. If you want to take some easy step, just don't vote for her. Don't support the matriarchy. And then you have some leverage, and you could say, well, I didn't vote for her, so, you know, I don't feel bound to follow her marching orders, which will just be the New World Order's marching orders. She'll just be a spokesperson for them, and say, don't worry, everybody, it's okay. Mom says it's okay, so don't worry. No, we worry a lot about what Mom says is okay, actually, because she says it's okay to believe that the impossible is merely difficult, which is the very root of mental illness. So she's saying mental illness is okay. It's not okay. Okay, the Dharma kings say mental illness is not okay. Clarity Ross, Dharma Prince Clarity Ross, says mental illness is not okay. You're not going to think it's okay. You're going to think this is not okay with me. Okay, this is not what I really want at all. So, first step, just don't vote for Hillary. If you need to leave the president blank, just don't vote for the president then. If you don't want to vote for Trump, you say I don't want to say I voted for him either. I don't vote, so I don't have a dog in the fight. I don't have a dog in the fight. I'm not beholden to any party at all. I don't support either party. I don't support any party, actually. So I'm not beholden to any political party whatsoever. I'm not beholden to their marching orders in the slightest bit. I don't support any of them. Just don't vote for her. That's the first step. Don't vote for them. Don't support the matriarchy. You know, it's your grave. It's your mental illness. First, you'll have severe mental illness, and then you'll have the grave. In between, you'll feel victim consciousness and demonize those you're blaming your problems on, and you'll be a nasty person, you know, really. And you won't like yourself at all. You'll have, you know, you'll cherish victim consciousness. And you'll end up with a dog, you know, dying with a dog and thinking that you lived a good life. But deep down you'll say, wow, you know, what a wimp I was, right? You let continuity fear bully you is what happened. Turn around, repent, and say, hey, I don't need to be bullied if I just win the battle of today. I won't let today bully me. And that's all I got to do. Just don't let today bully me. And then see how I feel tomorrow. Just repent. And then that's how you feel. When you repent, you say, hey, I can win the battle of today. You feel you got the confidence to win the battle of today. That's what happens when you repent. And you do win the battle of the day. And then you say, my God, that's the first battle. That's the first day I've ever won. But I did it. And then you get up the next morning and say, well, I did it yesterday. Let me see if I can win the battle of today. And then you win that battle too. And that's exactly how it goes for you. It's that simple. You can start it now. You can start it 1,000 years from now. You can start it 1,000,000 years from now. Or 1,000,000,000,000 years from now. Or you can start it today. You can say, I'm not going to let either the matriarchy or the patriarchy tell me what to do. I'm going to wow my success. I'm going to let the Holy Spirit tell me what to do. How about that? And the Holy Spirit's already with you. You don't have to elect the Holy Spirit. God elected it for you already, okay? So you can't de-elect the Holy Spirit. There's only one vote on the Holy Spirit, and that's God's vote. And God voted for the Holy Spirit. So it's with us forever, okay? Eternally with us. We can't hold an election and say, we're going to de-elect the Holy Spirit. No, there's only one ballot on the Holy Spirit, and that's God's ballot. Can't change that. Nothing we can do about that. So be fired up by this video, because this is very intense encouragement, isn't it? Very intense, wise encouragement, intense encouragement. Repent, and you will win the battle of today. This is what happened with me. Soon as I repented, I said, well, I can win this day. I can win the battle today. And it just started like that. Even though it seemed like the ego was, going to beat me, I said, well, maybe you might beat me every other day, ego, or continuity fear, really, dance of continuity fear. You may absolutely destroy me tomorrow, but I'm going to win today, because I have enough confidence to win today. And it may be the only day I ever win, but I'm going to do it. And I did it. And then I was in shock. I said, holy cow, that's amazing. And then I woke up the next day and I said, well, let me see if I can generate a little momentum. Let me see if I can, I'm going to win today too. And I won that day. And then I kept winning every day. And I kept generating more momentum and more confidence. That's repentance. That's how it works. It works. The way it worked for me is exactly the same way it'll work for you. Exactly. You will win. You will feel enough confidence to win the battle of today. And that breaks the spell of continuity fear upon you. And then you realize it really is just continuity fear. It's just a dance of continuity fear. And it's no dynamic of God or reality at all. I'm not really trapped at all. It's just this continuity fear is all it is. There's nothing. God is not trapping me at all. And you realize that and you say, wow, I'm going to be liberated. I'm going to be blissful once again. I'm going to experience blissful spirit of abidance once again. There's no doubt about it. This is going to happen down the road. I may win a lot of battles of today, but down the road, I've got this for sure. I've got this. And you'll feel that. Just like that. Just like that. So you win the battle of today, wowing your success. Don't worry if all this non-dual talk, whether you understand it or not. You just win the battle of today. Okay? Wowing your success. Keep commitment to wow your success, and then some success will arise for you. You're committed to wowing your success. You're not fighting problems. You're committed to wowing your success and trusting this will happen, and then this will bloom for you. It will start blooming. Your success will start to bloom for you. Okay? So this is, again, the key change is you expect success, you trust it, and you believe it's going to happen for you, and you're committed to wowing it. You're not going to go to mom and ask her what she thinks about it. You don't need mom's advice on what she thinks about it anymore, because you already know what to do. You're going to wow it. Wow. Very profound. You're not even turning over to dad, not over to neither mom nor dad. You're turning it over to the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit says, okay, just wow this. And you'll feel the spirit of thanks. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, thank you. There'll be some feeling of thanks and gratitude. Profound, very deep. You may not express it, but it's there. The shock of success, the wow of success. Just be committed to seeing that through and letting the ripples subside. And then the pebble will be thrown into your pool of success. The pebble of success will, Holy Spirit will start throwing these pebbles of success into your pool. It's like, whoa, wow. Because you're committed to letting the ripples die down and not running to mom or dad to ask them, what do you think about it? How do you analyze this? How do you see it? What are my prospects? What should I do? No, we're going to trust the Holy Spirit and the Dharma Kings who are absolutely confident in our success. They know the way. Well, I've used a lot of effort here, and I don't want to overdo it. This has been an intense workout. Election season special here, right? We're down to the last 17 days now, so it's time to roll out this, you know, really epic video. Not that the other ones haven't been; they have been, but you should be used to it by now, so you're able to handle how epic this video is, because it's all here. It's all here. You don't need to spend thousands of years waiting for it to all be here. It's all here right now, right here, right now. It's here today for you. That's the whole point of this. It's here today. The technique, you know, the advice, it's all the right advice right here, right now. Very simple. And it's all based on repentance. Repentance is to realize, hey, it's not difficult, it's impossible, and therefore, but oops, I've generated tremendous continuity fear, so that's really the only problem I have. I don't have to keep trying to do the impossible. I recognize if it's impossible, obviously God doesn't want me to try to do the impossible. So what I do now, oh, there's a lot of continuity fear. Okay, let me work on that now. Instead of trying to work on trying to do the impossible, we work on evaporating continuity fear. That's the difference between, you know, the spirit of non-abidance and the spirit of abidance. Trying to keep believing that we're just trying to do what's really difficult, it's a spirit of non-abidance. You'll feel that continuously. Evaporating our continuity fear leads us back to spirit of abidance. Spirit of abidance, rest upon me. Jesus Christ, thanks for setting me free. Jesus Christ, set me free. Spirit of abidance, rest upon me. Thank you, Jesus, for setting me free. Now, it's Jesus that jumped into my defense right off the bat, but that's because it was culturally acceptable for me that this is the savior figure that Judeo-Christianity would expect, and so Jesus jumped in and to my defense right away. As soon as I repented, you know, Jesus was there and said, you got it, this is it, I'll help you with this, I'll make sure you will not fail. I will not let you fail. Different cultures have different archetypes of the grace of God. Jesus, Christ Jesus, is the grace of God. It's what we really are, okay? It's the spirit of abidance itself in a cultural context. Hindus might, Rama Maharshi might jump, be the first one to show up, or Sri Sri Nanamayama, or Buddhists, it might be Longchenpa that shows up first. It doesn't matter. That's just a cultural thing. They all show up eventually, okay? They all show up eventually. And ultimately, you show up because they are you, okay? They are you. And we are the blissful spirit of abidance itself. That is what we are. So how can I sit here bringing it like this for 2.5 hours, you might be wondering. Is he going to be all right? Yeah, I'm great. I feel great because I'm in great shape. I'm in great core, my core, physically, everything. I'm able to handle this. Plus, I've been doing it for so long. I mean, that's a talent. That's a momentum. This is valuable to be able to do this. It's valuable help for the Dharma Kings. They know it. This doesn't just grow on trees. You don't just pick someone off the street and says, I want you to be able to witness the truth like this for 2.5 hours. It's not going to happen, is it? I mean, you find me someone off the street who can do this. Consider that. Who do you know that can do this? And where do you go to find someone this? You go to the gas station, you go to a bar, you go to a movie theater. Pick someone out of a movie theater that can do this, all right? Or someone watching a sporting event, some of the, you know, football game. Find me someone at the football game that can deliver the goods like this. Find me someone in the market, in the mall. Find me someone in the mall. Okay? So where are you going to find someone who can deliver the goods like this? Start thinking about that. That's a good practice right there. Someone at a music festival is going to deliver, be able to deliver it like this? Keep in mind that I'm going to be, after this, I'm still going to be smoothed out, wowing my day, and just not breaking stride at all. And you know, right, that I'm going to win the battle of today for sure. Almost for sure, you know, right? I don't want to put too much pressure on myself, but with the grace of God, I certainly, this is my focus. I'm not going to count my chickens till they're hatched. I never count the day as won until it's the day is done. Don't count the day as won until the day is done. That should be a little mantra. I don't count the day as won until the day is done. And even then, right, I'm go to bed, I'm still working on it. So this fitness doesn't come from the culture we have now in the world, does it? Where are you going to go in this matriarchal culture? You're going to find this. Where are you going to go? They say, nah, take it easy. You know, go shopping. You know, and tomorrow work on that. This is all about working on today. This is a result of working on today, of winning the battle of today for so many days. That's the result. That's why. That's the only reason why I'm here doing this, is I have been focusing on winning the battle of the day for so long. That's the only reason. You can't go somewhere and just pluck somebody out and say, hey, you can do this. It's easy, right? No, they'll collapse. So, you know, I feel great sitting here doing this. I'm on the balls of my feet. I'm forward, leaning forward. I'm not collapsed in any way. And I've brought extreme intensity here, heart intensity, compassion, clarity, everything, presenting it spontaneously for the world to view. And I'm sitting here, I'm calm, I'm feeling great. It's definitely a wow factor, I'm aware of. Like, wow, this is really great. I'm wowing myself. Yeah, that is great. Through right effort. That realizing by being committed to wow my success, that's what results in success. Not trying to be successful first and then wowing it. Then I struggle and get my own, I'm in my own way. It's tomorrow I'll be successful. Tomorrow. I love you tomorrow. Tomorrow is only a day away or something. No, I don't love tomorrow. I love today. I love the battle of today. I love winning the battle of today. I don't think about tomorrow. I really don't make plans. My plan is to win the battle of today. That's my plan. That's always my plan. Win the battle of today. And that's all I'm thinking about, really. And I really don't plan for tomorrow. I really don't. I really don't think ahead. I've trained myself. World is full of people that have all their tomorrows planned, and yet they can't win today to save their lives. They cannot win today to save their lives. They cannot win today to save themselves from mental illness, and yet they have all their tomorrows already planned. Sandcastles. castles made of sand. So, we'll let all the tomorrows be sandcastles, but we will win the battle of today here. Okay, that's what we do. Be willing to wow your success. That's how you win the battle of the day. Get up in the morning and say, today I'm going to be super successful, and I've got to prepare my mind for that. I've got to prepare my mind. And it's difficult to be successful. We're so used to failure, right? It's so easy to fail because we're used to it. It's really not that easy because mental illness is not easy at all. It's hell. But we're so used to it, we think, oh, yeah, it's so much easier to fail. Not really, because we keep on failing. And that's a tough road. That's a brutal road. So it's worth to put the effort to succeed. Even though, yeah, it takes your attention, doesn't it? You got to put your attention in. And you got to give your attention, and I got to manage it. Absolutely. How are we doing here with the video? Doing very well. Full video here today. Full video. It's a Saturday. Wow, last time I looked at my watch, it was 1:07. It's now 2:35. A lot of singers can deliver a song. Can they deliver a 2-hour and 30-minute full-on concert? That's the question, isn't it? All these tough girls and guys, you know, they think they're all that. Yeah, I can get up there, I can listen to me roar, I can sing this song. How about delivering 2.5 hours of that and even more and better? And then do it again tomorrow. And then do it again the next day, right? And do it every day. Do it every day. What? Mom, some crazy guy is telling me I'm supposed to do 2.5 hours of singing every day. Hey, Mom, protect me from this, you know, right? Mom says, you're great. You could sing this song. Aren't you wonderful? You're really wonderful. Right? Yeah, wonderfully lazy. Wonderfully lazy. Which is, you'll find out, mental illness. You don't repent. You're insane. This is true. You're trying to make the impossible possible. That's insanity. You got nowhere else to go but insanity with that. It's just you keep trying to find acceptable forms of insanity. And that the very effort, struggle to do that is what makes you kept severely insane. And projecting severe battles, conflicts. And you get tired of conflict, and then you collapse into the severe insanity because you don't project it anymore. But then that helps you ultimately come to grips with and say, wow, I got to repent here. I got to repent. I got to stop trying to change reality. It's impossible. It's not difficult. It's impossible. It's not difficult. It's impossible. You get the hackers, they hit a good drive, and they say, see, I'm like a pro. And the pros laugh and say, hey, try 72 holes of a 4-day tournament and try to, you know, hit a good drive every hole under all that pressure. We'll see how you do, huh? When there's a lake, it's the 18th hole, you need to birdie the hole. You gotta crush it right by near the lake, you know, and to get the distance. And you got to really crush your drive here because you need birdie on this hole. Let's see how you do then. the hacker gets up to the tee, and in their mind, it's like they realize I'm doomed. You know, I'm doomed. I'm doomed. I know the feeling, like, right? I'm not going to birdie this hole. They realize I need a miracle. Well, if they pray for a miracle, they'll get it. But the miracle for the pro is that they've prepared. It's the miracle of preparation. It is the best miracle of all. So everybody's crying for miracles. Well, the best miracle is a miracle of preparation, is winning the battle of today. That's the best, that's the ultimate miracle right there. And that's the one that we keep avoiding. We say, I want miracles tomorrow. I want all my miracles to come tomorrow. And we're avoiding the ultimate miracle, which is winning the battle of today, which is by being willing to wow our success today. That is the ultimate miracle that really succeeds for us. So the miracle of right preparation, the pros have that. Pros have that shot. They bring it on home. They bring it on home. It's not how you start, it's how you finish. So the miracle of preparation is the miracle of winning the battle of today. That's the greatest miracle. That's the one the world has been avoiding. Avoiding, 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 avoiding. Say, well, let mom take care of the day, not the